Welcome back to the second part of the series of talks about PGA. I will now show you some algebra after Stephen has given you an impression of the geometry in the first talk. This one is called the attack of the mirrors because mirrors will turn out to be central to the way we look at things. The PGA, at the end of the talk, you will realize that all the elements that you like to be available, the planes, the lines, the points, but also the transformations, motors, we call them in the form of translators and rotators, reflections, everything is present in a unified framework, which not only has the present, but also integrates the object and the operators. You will see in gray that a lot of familiar but rather specialized geometrical representations like Blücher coordinates, Lie algebra, homogeneous coordinates are just naturally embedded. But we will see that it's done in a very real and understandable manner, despite the fact that, let's say, dual quaternions are also included. And we have the pleasure to say that that empowers the programmer. And really, once you get and dig this way of thinking about things and expressing them, we hope that you will agree that you are able to do things that you didn't dare to do before. It's not only pretty, it's also frugal and efficient. Stephen showed you some of that. And, we happen to think it's fun. So the sections in my talk are that we are first talking about mirrors, then we're talking about operators and objects and their relationship. We'll do a little bit of interpolation. I'll show you how orthogonal projections are included, and then hope to summarize with that it just seems to be just right when you look at it this way. So it's all done with mirrors. We are going to develop an algebra to support what Stephen explained. So we are going to talk about planes as the basic elements of this algebra. They will actually be represented as vectors, but that doesn't need to concern us just yet. We're going to set it up in such a way that the formula for representing one plane, this red plane, in this yellow plane to become this blue plane will take a form like this. It'll be a sandwich product with a sort of unknown product that is defined by the functionality we desire from it. So here I take the element x, I sandwich it between a and its inverse, I plug a minus sign into it, and this is my reflection formula. Now, like I said, we're going to take this as the core of our need to define a proper product that helps us do this. But you immediately see that if I would plug in the mirror A itself instead of the X, then whatever A inverse means, it should be 1. So I get minus A, and that means that apparently we have an oriented geometry. We have not only planes, but we have planes that have sides, and the mirror A with its shiny side on this side, if you reflect it in itself, its shiny side gets to the other side, and this is what the minus means. Gradually, as you start working through this, you find that this product is not that exceptional at all. It's just a bilinear product, so bilinear in each of its terms. We're going to assume associativity, so you don't have to worry about brackets. We should say it's not generally commutative, because otherwise this formula would be rather trivial. And we'll have to say that a plane squares to a scalar. In fact, it's one of those geometric numbers that Stephen was talking about that have a positive square. Now, of course, you already know how to represent planes if you do homogeneous coordinates. You're used to having to store the n-dimensional normal vector and some kind of a scalar number which indicates how far it is from the origin. And basically in PGA we do exactly the same thing. So our plane vector is going to be an n of unknown dimensionality and a bit of something else which reflects the distance to the origin, and the something else we give a special name, we call it e. As we work through this, we find that it is very convenient to define e squared to be 0. So it's again one of those geometric numbers. And in formula after formula, we will find out that this is actually like the plane at infinity. And you sort of see that here. If I let d, the delta, become very big, so I have a plane at very large distance from the origin, then this term dominates. And so e is like a plane at infinity. Now you may see PGA denoted as RD, 0, 1, and that means that there are D positive dimensions. These are the dimensions that correspond to the Euclidean part of the normal vector that characterizes the plane. That we don't do negative vectors, we don't need them in PGA, and we have one vector that squares to zero, one basis vector, and that is the plane at infinity. And what we will be working in, of course, our illustrations will be mostly D equals 2 and 3, but it will actually work in arbitrary dimensions. All right, immediately we see that the algebra encodes for some geometrical relationship. So if I take a plane that is perpendicular to a plane A, so the geometry is B is perpendicular to A, then by this reflection operator, we see that, this is a plane. If I reflect it in plane A, it stays itself, right? So we should have this equation. And if I multiply on the right by A, then that means AB equals minus BA. So the algebraic anti-commutation relationship between two planes reflects their geometric orthogonality. And this happens again and again. So we find that these things that we'd like to talk about in geometry have a very simple and clean representation for the geometric product, which is, of course, why the product is called geometric. And in several of the derivations that I will do in the following, this especially holds for the coordinate planes. Let's see what E1 is. E1 is a plane that passes through the origin because there's no delta, and its normal vector is in the E1 direction. This is the coordinate plane with a normal vector in the E2 direction. And if I swap them in the product, then I get a minus sign because they are orthogonal. Let's also include that special plane E in this, make it orthogonal to all the other planes. And let's make, identical planes commute. E1, E1 will always be E1, E1. Well, with these rules, we will be able to compute the product of planes. And what do we hope to get out of multiplying planes? Well, this again is given by repeated application of the reflection operator. You saw Stephen do it. Let's now use our new formula to see what would happen. So if I have something that first reflects in a plane A1 and then in the plane A2, then because of the associativity of the geometric product, I can bunch these things together. The inverse of two elements is the inverse of the product of the elements in opposite order, right? If you first put on your socks and then your shoes, then if you want to reverse that, you take your shoes off and then your socks off. Then we see that there's a new element that occurs in a group, A1, A2, multiplying from right to left, that occurs twice. I have a new sandwich product, and this should be, we know this from the geometry that Stephen showed, well, if the two planes were parallel, it should be a translation operator. If the two planes intersected in a line, it should be a rotation around that line. So just by continuing this original scheme that we had of the sandwiching, we find these elements in our algebra that should be the translation and the rotation operator. These are, of course, going to be our basic motions when we do Euclidean motions. And we're going to combine them. It's good to have a name for them. We call them a motor because they move things. Motors are the computational elements of the plane-based geometric algebra. Right? And so we don't have objects yet, but at least we have general motions of a Euclidean kind. So in our total scheme, we have now seen the vectors. We'll call them grade one elements because they consist of only one vector, which has the plane and the infinite plane and used as a plane reflector. And we're now beginning to see that if we combine two of those reflections or four of those reflections, we may get more general elements. But we still have a lot to discover in this total scheme. Let's look at what it actually looks like. So I'm going to do this in a slightly general form. I'm not going to choose coordinates or anything like that. I just say I have two parallel planes, so they have the same n, but they may have different distances to the origin, delta 1 and delta 2. I use the geometric product in precisely the way that I might expect to do with a bilinear product. So if I have terms like this, I first multiply this and that and that and that, and I get four terms. Now, this first term I recognize because n times n, I said that's the same as n dot n, it's 1 because I'm using normalized normal vectors. This thing, well, e and n e, they are just one of those orthogonal things. So en is minus ne, so this actually becomes one total term that combines in this manner. And here, if I imply that ne equals minus en, I get an e squared, and I know that e squared equals 0, so this term disappears. Well, wait a minute, what is this? This is the normal vector times the distance between the two. Okay, we know that that's twice the translation vector that we're expecting, so let's call the translation vector t. And I have now, for the first time, a view of what the product of two planes looks like. This is a translation motor. And it has this form. It has a scalar and it has a grade 2 object, the product of two vectors. And for future references, I can even rewrite this in an exponential form. This is a bit silly because I'm including terms that are 0 because e squared equals 0. But if I do that, then I can write this as an exponential. We'll do that to combine it nicely with rotations a bit later. And now you see that the internal algebra of this scheme that I'm setting up also has the consequence that if I do one translation and I do another translation after it, then the total motor that I get is the product of these two. And again, when I expand out all the terms that I get, I see that I get an e squared term that I don't see. And the only thing that is left is that the product of two translations is also a translation, but the vector that it translates over is the vector sum of their two parametrization. The two translation vectors. So the algebra automatically becomes completely correct for something like translations, precisely because I have dared to take this geometric number that squares the zero. Okay, let's see what happens to rotation operators. Now, here I'm going to choose special coordinates to make my computation a little bit easy, but I know that I can use translation motors to bring it anywhere. So this is not a restriction, but I'm taking a P1 equals E1, P2 a rotated version over E1. I'm expecting half the rotation angle to play a role to get a full rotation over phi, so I've encoded that in here. And now I do exactly the same kind of geometric product that I did before, and I find that it simplifies in a different way. I again get something that squares to a scalar, so I get a scalar term, and I can get something that is E1, E2, which is one of those grade 2 terms. But I already know from Steven's talk that I may expect that the product of two orthogonal planes, which is what E1 and E2 are, should be a line. And so I might dare to write this as cosine phi minus L times sine phi over 2. If I can convince myself that this is indeed the rotation line. And then I can even write it in this form. What do I need to do that? Well, you've seen this before, maybe with complex numbers, and then there was an I here that squared to minus 1. So I'm allowed to do this algebraically if this thing squares to minus 1, but it does. So I have a real line here, the intersection of two planes, E1 and E2. I multiply it by itself, E1 and E2. I know that if I swap these two, I get a minus sign, and then I have E1 squared, E2 squared. I know that each of those are normalized, so they square to 1. So indeed, my L squared is minus 1, and I am allowed to write this expression. Now, this is really very pleasant, because there is an arbitrariness in the two planes that define the rotation. That is that gauge freedom that Stephen was talking about. But I have now managed to get a representation of these planes, of the rotation operator, that only talks about the line it rotates around and the angle by which it rotates. This is, of course, very, very pleasant. You know, and I have now chosen my coordinate system that the line passes through the origin, but we'll see with a little bit of reasoning that I have chosen my origin to make this computation simple, but it works for any line because I could have chosen the origin anywhere. All right, so we obviously now need to talk about that line a bit more because we're very interested in having that as an object. And the line common to two planes is a bivector. How would I construct that in general? I've seen that I can do it if I have two orthogonal planes. What if my planes are not orthogonal? Well, you can easily derive that AB and BA are both invariant under the rotation operator made out of the two planes, AB and BA. And I also want the line to have an orientation so that rotating from A to B would be in an opposite sense to rotating from B to A. So I'm interested in the anti-symmetric combination of these two things, and this is indeed precisely how it is defined in the PGA. We define a new product, which is a linear combination of just geometric products, so it's not really that new, as A wedge B. It's the intersection of the two lines, so we call it a meet product or an outer product or a wedge product, there are different names there. And you see that A wedge A equals zero, so it has some very special properties. Now, if you do that for general planes, then you'll find that you get development of E1, E2, then delta times E, other things here. You get three terms that together indicate the direction of the line, and you get three terms that together indicate where the line is. And in fact, this wedge product is just our way of encoding what you may know as Plucker coordinates of lines, the six-dimensional representation of lines. But it's fully embedded in the algebra so far because it is a linear combination of geometric products. Okay, well, Stephen said that if you have three orthogonal planes, that is that determines a point reflector and therefore it determines a point. That is true too if you take the wedge product, if the planes are not totally orthogonal. Let's develop a simple example of what a point looks like in geometric algebra by taking a coordinate plane in the E1 direction, shifted over X1, over E2 in the direction X2, over the amount X2, and E3 over the amount X3. You then fully multiply all these things and you see that you get something that is E1, E2, E3, minus a term that I can factorize something out of, just to show that the position vector that you're usually using to encode this thing is still present, of course, in the PGA representation. Now, there's two special things in here. This is the product of the three coordinate planes. We are in 3D. And there's the product of the three coordinates plane and the plane at infinity. These will occasionally occur in the rest of my presentation. We'll call this O because it's the point at the origin, obviously, when x equals 0. And we call this I. That's a common term for the biggest element that you can make in a space, the pseudoscalar. But in here you see that on a somewhat weird basis, this one, this point just has the coordinates 1, x1, x2, x3. So it's homogeneous coordinates, but now not completely isolated from the operations because it's actually a reflector, which is actually the intersection of three planes. And because it is so integrated in the total system, you can make the point reflector as reflecting something like minus x, y, x inverse, with x a point. Now, I've now given you enough information to see that we can fill all the elements that we could make from an original basis of a scalar, the three Euclidean vectors, the special vector, which is denoted E0 here. We naturally get things that are E2 wedge E3, so bivectors. We get things that are bivectors that involve that special thing E. We have seen the trivectors occurring in the points, and we have also seen that in the representation the four-element vector occurs. So on this whole basis, we can group things together in different ways to actually have lines, points, planes, even screws, as we'll see. We have rotation operators, translation operators, they can be combined to motors. We have the plane reflectors and the point reflectors. Everything is integrated in this one rather small, 16 dimensional for a 3-dimensional space, but we completely recognize that all these things we need. And it's even nice to see that they slightly overlap. That overlap is not a bug, it's actually a geometrical relationship between these things. You can multiply two points to get a translation operator. All right, so I focused a little bit on translations and rotations separately. You can multiply these together, and we have seen that Steven showed us that we can expect that this simplifies to, you know, if you apply 100 of them together, you will still get something that is not more than, let's say, a rotation along around a line with a translation along that line. This is all true, and it can be proved. Actually, what we get is dual quaternions. But dual quaternions as motors are not mystically complex dimensional things that occur from somewhere that were given to us by mathematics. No, we've seen that they are just repeated reflections in planes, in an even number of planes if you have a motor. And moreover, our representation of the motions is not totally disjunct from our representation of the things that we'd like to move, because we can apply them to any element by disenriching. And there are indeed some special cases. If you're in two, at one point in 3D, then you get quaternions. If you're at one point in 2D, then actually they are the same as complex numbers. If you are without rotations in n dimensions, then you actually have something that is like position vectors. All of these things are totally integrated and recognizable. And this is that property that is really at the basis of why GA programs are so simple. As long as I build things from geometric products, then it's obvious that if I define the transformation of such a composite object by, well, first transform one and then multiply it with the transform of the other, then these things in the middle cancel. So I never have any issue of how I constructed this object. It will always transform by a sandwiching product. And that explains why in the code for transforming a point, a direction, a line with whatever motor you have, whether it's a translation, rotation, or combined, the program is just always m times b times the inverse of m, which is indicated with a twiddle here because we usually normalize these things, so we don't have to compute inverses either, just reverse their order. This simplifies code, of course, enormously, because I wouldn't even have to write this code. I just write this in my program. As long as I can read that this geometric algebra, I'm allowed to do so. It doesn't affect the readability. I want to say something about interpolation of motion. We have seen that the exponential of a line with its angle gives us a rotation operator, and that this line is actually the invariant of the motion that we do. We can write any motor as the exponential of the bivector thing, the two-element thing, intersection here, that it keeps invariant. And this is a general principle, but we can also invert it. So if we have a motor, we can retrieve the thing that it rotates around, the direction it translates in, or the combination of the two. And that means that if we want to do motions partially, we can just interpolate them by taking the nth root of the motor, which is, you know, taking the logarithm divided by n and re-exponentiating. And this is very convenient because the space that I get of these bivectors that characterize the invariance is actually a flat linear space. So if I have a sequence of poses that I want to visit, I extract their bivectors, I do some kind of an interpolation between these bivectors to make a smooth curve in bivector space, like a spline, and then I re-exponentiate the intermediate bivectors that I get, and that gives me full control over a smooth motion that I have in between. And Steven has done some simulations to show that this way of doing it via a logarithm gives you much, much better behavior than weird things like Euler angles with all their discontinuities, than even quaternion interpolation, which is closely related but not quite doing the log, and something that is called Cayley interpolation, which is a somewhat simplified form of that. Effectively, what we're doing is interpolating in the Lie algebra, but notice that we don't need special mathematical terms to describe what we're doing, because it's absolutely straightforward. All right, so we'll find that once you work with motions, these bivectors will play a very important role. And we're going to see that in the fourth talk as well, where physical motion, dynamic motion of heavy things, not all equally heavy in the same direction, etc., will very heavily depend on the bivector part of the geometric algebra. All right, so I've focused now on motions, but maybe you also want to do more general things. There is another part of the geometric product. We've seen that the wedge product, which intersected planes, is something that involved the asymmetric combination, anti-symmetric combination of geometric products. If you take the symmetric combination, which is obviously the other part, you get a familiar friend. It's a dot product. So this is capable of measuring length and measuring the cosine of the angle and things like that. By a little bit of effort, you can extend this to act between arbitrary elements of the algebra. And again, it's not a new product. Everything is still writable as the sum of geometric products, and therefore everything still transforms in the same way. That's very handy. And now we get a general projection formula where you take an element x, you want to project it onto an element a, and what you do is x dot a with this new dot product divided by a, and it has a satisfying interpretation. So here I have a red plane and a red point. If I project the point onto the plane by x dot p divided by p, I get indeed the blue point that you expect. But what you maybe had not expected is that if you project the point on the plane onto the point, I get this blue plane, which actually is the plane passing through the point parallel to the original one. And this also works for lines. So the red line can be projected on the red plane by this formula, L dot P divided by P. But the plane can also be brought into coincidence with the line by P dot L divided by L. In fact, we get a completely coordinate-free relationship. As soon as we have two objects, they sort of divide the space into parallel, coincidence, orthogonal things that are all very simply encodable by little formulas that do not intend on splitting them into where they are and in which direction they are. It all works like this. The intersection point we've seen before is just P wedge L, of course. So this is handy. It's handy language to think in, and it's a handy language to use. What we have when we have projections is that, if you think about what matrices or linear mappings do, is that a matrix can be written as how things behave when they are projected on certain basis elements, how much they extend, etc., and then recompose them. So that means that with the projection, we also have any general linear operator, but now in a much more pleasant setting in which everything we make transforms according to the motions of the space we're interested in. So any linear operation is also available, but it is definitely a good habit that if you have a special set of motions that you're interested in our case the Euclidean motions, you go to an algebra in which these motions become motors, these exponentials of bivectors. And that automatically has a consequence of the space that you're looking at. So we have seen that for the Euclidean PGA, when we take planes as vectors, we get motors that do Euclidean transformations. If you go to, say, spheres as vectors, you get conformal transformations because there are multiple reflections in spheres. And each of the different algebras that we have already developed or seen develop in the field have their own way of making a certain group of motions really simply representable. All right, so the summary is that I hope you are becoming convinced that this is the right way of doing it, that all these old ways we had are certainly incorporated, and you don't have to forget about them. It's just that they are now interrelated and they are at your fingertips because of the very simple way in which they are included. Geometric products, dot products, wedge products, logarithms, exponentials. Those are the basis for developing your code. The code is also very efficient because basically you are still juggling coordinates around, except not at the level of where you're programming. If you like that table, we have a mug that we can sell you that contains it. Stephen has built quite a collection of things, which is called the Ganja Coffee Shop, in which things are available online. Here you see a link with quite a library of operations that you might want to do, that each have their own individual programs and things. Here's the 3D PGA. One of the things, for instance, is I give the link to here. This is the interpolation, the nice interpolation between two extremal rotations of a rod, where classically you get a candy wrap phenomenon if you don't do it carefully enough. But of course, in the geometric algebra interpolation, you get a much more smooth way of doing that. And this concludes this part of the presentation.